Okay, good morning. Let's start. So last time we studied that if there are n random variables, then the expectation information is summarized by this mu vector. This is the vector of expectations. Mu 1 is the expectation, the mean of the first random variable, mu 2 is that of the second random variable, and so on. And if there are n random variables, then the risk information is summarized by this matrix V, the n by n matrix called variance-covariance matrix. The 1-1 element is the variance of the first random variable, and the 1-2 element is the covariance of the first and second random variable, and so on. And we studied the expectation formula and the variance formula. The expectation formula says that if there are n random variables, and if you know the expectations of all the n random variables, then the expected value of a linear combination of the n random variables is just mu times w. Mu is the vector of expectations of the n random variables, and w is the column vector of these non-random coefficients. Okay? And the variance formula also has a very simple sandwich form. So the variance of a linear combination of n random variables is equal to w transpose times v times w. Again, w is the coefficient, the vector of coefficients, and v is the variance-covariance matrix. The first w is in the form of a row vector, and second w is in the form of a column vector. Okay. In the context of portfolio risk management, random variables are asset returns. Asset returns are random. If there are n assets, then there are n random variables. Okay? So in the context of portfolio risk management, mu is the vector of asset expected returns of the n assets. And V is the variance-covariance matrix, the risk information of the n asset returns. But mu and V are given to you. Mu and V are information that you can ask from your portfolio manager or analyst. They can estimate these things using the past data. So there's nothing you can do about mu and V. What you can choose is the portfolio weights. So W is your portfolio weights. Like, okay, I'm going to invest 50% of my money in the first asset and 3% of my money in the second asset, and so on. You can choose whatever portfolio you like. Mathematically, portfolio is just a vector of n numbers, portfolio weights. The only constraint you face is that the portfolio weights should sum up to 1. Right? Once you construct a portfolio, then the portfolio return, which is random, is just a linear combination of the individual asset returns. Okay, once you construct a portfolio, portfolio return is just a linear combination of the n asset returns, and therefore, you can compute the expected return on your portfolio using the expectation formula. You can compute the variance, the risk of your portfolio return, using the variance formula. So the next question is, how can we choose? How should we choose our portfolio? And that is the portfolio choice problem. There are several types of, there are several ways to choose your own portfolio. The first example is the risk-targeted portfolio choice. Again, remember, in the context of a portfolio choice problem, mu w is the expected return of your portfolio w. Mu is the vector of portfolio expected, mu is the vector of expected returns of the n assets. And this sandwich form is the risk of your portfolio. in this first type of problem, you are choosing your portfolio weights W to max to minimize the risk of your portfolio, subject to two constraints. The second constraint merely says that the portfolio weights should sum up to one. The first constraint says the first constraint sets the minimal acceptable expected return. Okay? It doesn't have to be 10%, it can be any number. But basically in this problem you are saying, okay, I'm going to choose my portfolio weights. W is the N numbers, N W's. I'm going to choose my portfolio to minimize the risk of the portfolio return, subject to the extent that the expected return of the portfolio is no smaller than 10%. Okay? I want at least 10% in expectation. You can choose this number 10%, it doesn't have to depend 10%. If you can tolerate very small expected return, if you're okay with like 1% or 2% expected return, then you can make this variance very, very small. If you require like 20% or 30%, I want 30% expected return from my portfolio, then you cannot make this variance very small. So of course there is some risk-return trade-off, and this number reflects your risk preference. The second example, the second type of portfolio choice problem is the return-targeted portfolio choice. Here, the role of the expected return and risk of the portfolio are switched. Now you are saying, okay, I'm going to choose my portfolio W to maximize the expected return subject to the risk, the standard deviation of the portfolio being no greater than 30%. And the variance is just the square of the standard deviation. Don't forget that mu and v are given to you. Okay? Mu and v are about information about the any individual asset returns. You can do nothing about mu and v. What you can choose is W. Again, that doesn't have to be 30% squared. You can choose this number. If you can tolerate very large variance, then you can make your expected return very large. So there is always risk-return trade-off. The third type of the problem has both expected return and variance in the objective. And this type of portfolio choice problems try to get the right balance between risk and return. So you want to maximize this thing, but there should be negative sign in front of the variance, because you know return is a good thing, variance is a bad thing. There should be negative because you want to impose penalty on large risk, but this coefficient doesn't have to be 1/2. It can be large number, it can be small number. If you really hate variance, if you really hate risk, then this number, this coefficient should be large. If you can tolerate very large risk, then this number can be really close to zero. Okay, that's the third type of portfolio choice problem. So far, so good. Any question? Okay, so we could solve these problems by the Lagrange multiplier method. You learned Lagrange multiplier method. In that case, we would be solving them analytically, but in this module we don't pursue to solve these problems analytically. Instead, we are going to solve these problems, these optimization problems, numerically using a computer. Okay? So I'm going to demonstrate Excel, starting with basic matrix algebra using Excel, and then I'll solve these portfolio optimization problems, portfolio choice problems, by using Excel solver. So let us start with a simple basic matrix algebra. So here we have three matrices. The first matrix is 3 by 2, the second is 2 by 2, and the third matrix is 3 by 2, 2 by 3. And let's transpose the first matrix, and also let's do matrix multiplication. Let's multiply the first two matrices. For that purpose, it's convenient to give some names to them. So I name the first matrix as A, and the second matrix as B, and so on. So highlight the region for the first matrix. Click on the name bar at the top left corner, and I type A. Okay? I'll name this matrix A. Press Enter. Sorry. So this part is now called A. Okay? Similarly, let's name. You can give any name. You can, any name like Bob, Tom, Alice. But you can not give names like A1 or X1 or X2 because such names refer to these particular cells in Excel. But otherwise, you can give any names. Let's name the second matrix B. Okay, so this part is now B, and this one, I don't think we can use C, because C refers to entire column in Excel. So let's name this part D instead. Okay? And let's transpose matrix A. So matrix A is a 3 by 2. So if we transpose it, it is going to be 2 by 3. So select a 2 by 3 region and click on the function bar. Start with equal. You should always start with equal whenever you want to enter some equation. And the function we are going to use here is a transpose function. If you click on this link, you can find a description of the transpose function, how to use it. Okay, it doesn't. Well, anyway. So transpose, we want to transpose matrix A, so I just simply type A, okay? And immediately the region named A is highlighted. So let's compute transpose of A. And you should press, this is important, you should press Control Shift Enter. Whenever you use matrix functions, you cannot simply press Enter, you should press Control Shift Enter. Control Shift Enter, and this is the transpose of A. So instead of having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Transposing a matrix is simply switching rows and columns. Let's multiply matrix A and matrix B. Matrix A is 3 by 2, and matrix B is 2 by 2. So the product will be 3 by 2. So select a 3 by 2 region. Click on a function bar. Start with equal. This time, the function we use is a matrix multiplication function. That's M mult function. This function allows two inputs. The matrices we want to multiply are A and B. So I enter A and B, separating by a comma, and immediately A and B regions are highlighted. So if, and again, I should press Control Shift Enter. Three by two, sorry. Okay, I have to do this again. M mallet A, B, control shift, enter. Okay, this is A times B. Okay? Now let's multiply three things, A, B, and D. This is 3 by 2, this is 2 by 2, this is 2 by 3, so the A times B times D would be a 3 by 3 matrix. So again, I choose a 3 by 3 region and click on the function bar, type M mallet A, B, and D. I wish we could do this, but yeah, we cannot do this because the mmallet function allows to multiply only two matrices, not three matrices. So we cannot do this. So if we want to multiply three things, we have to nest two mmallet functions like this. So the first, we multiply A and B, and then multiply D. So the inner mmallet function multiplies A and B, and the outer mmallet function multiplies that result to D. Okay, control shift enter. This is A times B times D. Okay, easy, right? This is going to be part of the assignment, so understands that. And yeah, if you want to delete, I mean, again, you have to press Control Shift and Enter. Not only when you use a matrix function, but also when you modify these equations. So even when you want to delete this entire thing, you have to press Control Shift Enter. If you want to delete a name, so this region is called D. If you want to unname it, you cannot simply go to the name bar and delete it. It's still called D. If you want to delete a name, you have to go to if you have to go to this name manager. It depends on the version of the Excel you have. For this version, under the formula tab, there's name manager, and you open it, and you see the list of the names, and you choose the name you want to delete, and delete. Okay, after that, this part is no longer called D. Okay, that's matrix algebra basics. Let's do our main theme of portfolio optimization. So suppose there are only 12 companies currently traded in the market. Barclays, Burberry, Compass Food, Diageo, EasyJet, HSBC, Next, Pearson, Dutch Shell, Submira, Standard Chartered, and Vodafone. The first row under the names is the vector of expected returns of these companies' shares. The data is kind of old, but I think it serves for today's purpose. So it's 0.99% for Barclays, 2.01% for Burberry, and so on. These are monthly expected returns. The next row is the vector of their standard deviation. So for example, the risk of Compass Group is 7% per month. So although the expected return is 1%, the actually realized return can be like 8% or 10% or minus 6% or minus 10%. So it's very risky. And the next 12 by 12 region is the variance-covariance matrix. You might think that, yeah, so the diagonal components are variances, and off-diagonal components are covariances. You might think that these numbers are much smaller than the numbers we saw last time. If you remember, last time the variance of Aviva was like 200% squared, and the risk of British Gas 130% squared. They looked much larger, but actually it's the same. Percentage, this symbol, means 0.01, okay? So if you substitute 0.01 into that percentage symbol, it's everything is the same. Percentage squared is 0.0001. Okay? So yeah, these are the same magnitude. Okay. Let me name this vector of expected returns as mu. Let's just name it M. And I'll name this variance covariance matrix as V. A portfolio that is easiest to understand is the equally weighted portfolio. For equally weighted portfolio, you basically invest the same amount of money in each of the assets. Yeah? Because there are 12 assets here, the equally weighted portfolio invests at 1/12 of your money in each of the assets. So 1/12 is approximately equal to 0.0833. So this is the equally weighted portfolio. Let's name this vector weight 0. So now this region is called weight 0. Let's first confirm that these portfolio weights sum up to 1. So I'm going to compute the sum of these portfolio weights using sum function. And I want to sum up weight 0. Again, immediately, the region named weight 0 is highlighted. And we can confirm that the sum of these portfolio weights is actually 1. Now let's compute the expected return and the risk of this equally weighted portfolio. The formula for the expected return on a portfolio is mu times w. Our mu vector is named m, and the weight vector is weight 0. So we can use m marut function here. M marut, m times weight 0. But you know the weight vector should be in the form of a column vector, so that mu is 1 by n, and w is n by 1. So here I transpose weight 0. I close one bracket, and I close another bracket. It looks complicated, but it's just mu times w. Yeah? And Control-Shift-Enter. Don't forget to press Control-Shift-Enter. The expected return on the equally weighted portfolio is 1.12% per month. So far, so good. Let's compute the variance of the equally weighted portfolio return. So we use mmarut function. Portfolio weights in the form of a row vector times the variance covariance matrix, this red region we called V. And we have to multiply one more thing. Remember that sandwich formula, W times V times W. So we have to multiply three things. So we have to nest mmarut functions. So the last thing we want to multiply is the transpose of weight 0. Close one bracket, close the other bracket. OK. Again, it looks complicated, but it's just W times V times W. Okay, the variance formula for the portfolio return. Control-Shift-Enter, and the variance of the return on the equally weighted portfolio is 0.0031, 31% squared. The standard deviation is just the square root of the variance. So let's compute the standard deviation of the return on the equally weighted portfolio. So that's variance to the power 0.5. Is it too small for people sitting at the back? Can you see it? Is it okay? So taking exponentiating by 0.5 is the same as taking the square root, yeah? So the standard deviation of the equally weighted portfolio return is 5.6%. So So far, we haven't solved any portfolio optimization problem. We just computed the expected return and the risk of this particular portfolio called equally weighted portfolio. Now let's solve that first type of portfolio optimization problem, the risk-targeted portfolio choice. We are going to display the optimal solution, the optimal portfolio, in this region named weight 1. So I'll name this region weight 1. Okay, and I'm going to use the same equations. So let me copy and paste these equations we've just entered. But I have to modify these equations. Now, portfolio weights are not weight 0, but weight 1. And don't forget to press Ctrl Shift Enter even when you modify matrix equations. So for variance, we have to modify two parts from weight 0 to weight 1. OK, now they show no values because the portfolio weights are now blank. OK, then we use solver. The first time you use solver, you have to add it. The solver is in your computer. If you have Excel, the solver is already in your computer, so you don't have to download it. But solver is not something everyone uses. So the first time you use it, you have to add it. How to add it depends on the version of the Excel you have. For this version, I think go to Options and choose Add-ins and choose Solver Add-in and go to Go and check Solver Add-in and click OK. And after doing that, under the Data tab, you will see a solver icon. This is only for the first time, only the first time you use solver. And after that, click on the solver icon, and this solver window opens. So objective is, this is the risk-targeted portfolio optimization. So the objective is the risk of the variance of the return of the portfolio, which is in, the equation is in cell E26. So I choose cell E26 as the objective, and we want to minimize it. We want to minimize the variance of the return on the portfolio. By changing the portfolio weights, that should be displayed in this region named weight 1. So I type weight 1, subject to two constraints. The first constraint says that the sum of the portfolio weights should be equal to 1. The sum of the portfolio weights is computed here in cell E24. So I say, OK, E24 should be exactly equal to 1. That's the first constraint. And the second constraint is that, OK, the expected return of the portfolio, which is in cell E25, should be no smaller than some level. I can choose this level. Let me simply choose the expected return of the equally weighted portfolio. OK, so again, this problem says, OK, the objective is the variance of this portfolio return, which is now, which is in cell E26. I want to minimize it by changing the portfolio weights in weight 1. And there are two constraints. The first constraint says that the weights should sum up to 1. And the second constraint says that the expected return of this portfolio should be no smaller than that of the equally weighted portfolio. And solve. Solver found a solution. All constraints and optimality conditions are satisfied. So let's see what the portfolio looks like. Okay. So this portfolio invests 43% of your money in Diageo, 18% in Next. So if you start with £100,000, £43,000 goes to Diageo, £18,000 go to Next, £26,000 in Pearson, £14,000 in Submira, and £8,000 in Vodafone. Of course, then the amount will exceed £100,000. So you should do some short selling. This portfolio involves a lot of short selling. For example, this portfolio borrows and sells Burberry shares to get additional cash of £8,000. It also borrows and sells that share to get additional cash of £9,000. And by doing so, the expected return of this portfolio is the same as that of the equally weighted portfolio, 1.12%. But now the risk, the standard deviation of this portfolio return, is significantly smaller than that of the equally weighted portfolio. It's only 4.2%. Okay, that's the risk-targeted portfolio choice problem. Now let's do the return-targeted portfolio choice problem. We are going to maximize the expected return of the portfolio, and let's display the result here. I'm going to name this region weight 2. And again, I'll use the same equations. So I copy and paste the equations and modify the equations from weight 1 to weight 2. Don't forget to press Ctrl Shift Enter. If you press Ctrl Shift Enter, then if you do it successfully, then entire equation will be surrounded by these curly brackets. Then you got it right. If you just pressed Enter, then equations won't be surrounded by the curly brackets. Then you have to make sure to press Ctrl Shift Enter. Okay? And then we open the Solver window. Okay, now objective is the expected return of this portfolio, which is now in cell H25, and we want to maximize it by changing the portfolio weights displayed in the region named weight 2. And we should also modify the constraints. Oh, where did it go? Okay, the sum of the portfolio weights is in cell H24, and this should be equal to 1. And okay, the second constraint is that, so this is the return targeted portfolio of choice, so the variance of the portfolio, the risk of the portfolio return, which is in cell H26, should be no greater than some level. Again, this level I can choose. I choose the variance of the equally weighted portfolio. So that's 0.0031. Okay, so the objective is the expected return on the portfolio. We want to maximize it by changing the portfolio weights. And yeah, the portfolio weight should sum up to 1, and the risk shouldn't exceed the risk of the equally weighted portfolio. I click solve. Solver has converged to the current solution. All constraints are satisfied. Okay, let's see. So this portfolio invests £26,000 in Compass. Sorry, Diageo, 20% in EasyJet, 25% in Next, 42% in Submira, and lots of short selling. And by doing so, the expected return is, so the risk is the same as that equally weighted portfolio, yeah? But the expected return is now significantly higher than the equally weighted portfolio. It's 1.83% per month, okay? Now finally, let's solve the same problem without allowing short selling. Short selling is, you know, in reality, you may not want to do short selling because, yeah, short selling has additional cost. So if you have money, you want to invest in the stock market and probably just by buying some shares, no short selling at all. So let's do that. And let's display the result here. I name this region weight 3. And again, I copy and paste the same equations. And I change the equations from weight 2 to weight 3. Okay, and yeah, open the solver window. The objective is K25. We want to maximize it by changing weight 3. The sum of the portfolio weights is now in K24. And the variance is in K26. I think even if you cannot see it now, I think you can see it in the recording. And finally, check this box to make sure that the solution portfolio weights are non-negative. So by checking this box, I impose that these portfolio weights to be non-negative. So I'm not allowing for short selling this time. And click on solve. Solver has converged. Okay, let's see. 15% in Diageo, 16% in EasyJet, 22% in Next, 43% in Submira, and don't buy Barclays, Burberry, or Compass Group, or HSBC, or Vodafone. And by doing so, the risk is still the same as that of the equally weighted portfolio. But the return, expected return, okay, the expected return is lower than the last time, because last time we allowed for short selling. This time, we are not allowing short selling. So more constraint means lower expected return, but still the expected return is significantly higher than that of the equally weighted portfolio. Okay? So I think we have some more time left. So let me do one or two preliminaries for the next topic of the. So that was the risk management by the portfolio managers. Next example of the risk management is the risk management by insurance companies. And we have two preliminaries for this. First preliminary is the rough image of this notion of the standard deviation. random variables have their theoretical average, theoretical mean. But the actual realization of the random variable can be much higher or much lower than the mean. And the standard deviation gives you the idea of, you know, the measure of such variability or risk of a random variable. Now, roughly speaking, I think this is the rough image that many practitioners have in mind about the standard deviation. Okay, so the outcome deviating from the mean by one standard deviation is very usual. Deviating from the mean by two standard deviations, by two sigmas, that's rare. But it can happen. Deviating from the mean by three sigmas, by three standard deviations, is very, very rare. Okay, that's the rough image of the standard deviation. For the normal distribution, for example, let's say mean is mu and standard deviation is sigma, the probability that the outcome is greater than the mean by more than one standard deviation is this area. The probability is 15.8%. The probability that the outcome is greater than the mean by more than two standard deviations is 2.2%. So it's rare, but that can happen. The outcome is greater than the mean by more than three sigmas, that happens with the probability 0.13%. So that's very rare, once in 1,000. That's the rough image. Of course, how exactly rare depends on the type of the distribution. Okay, these probabilities differ from distributions to distributions. And indeed, this rough image of the standard deviation comes from the normal distribution. However, there are many extremely heavy-tailed distributions for which 5 sigma event or 10 sigma event can happen with probability like 1%. Okay? I don't think 2% is possible, but yeah. The key mathematics for this is called Chebyshev inequality. So if you have heard of Chebyshev inequality, that's the math for this. If you're interested, you can go check the Wikipedia article for the Chebyshev inequality. But anyway, that's the rough image of the standard deviation, which I think is useful. The second preliminary is the binomial distribution. And I'm sure that most of you have studied the binomial distribution in your first year. And I'm sure that most of you have forgot, so if you forgot it, please watch this YouTube tutorial, excellent YouTube tutorial video for the binomial distribution by Khan Academy. I posted the link on the course website, so please watch it if you forgot it. Let's look at one simple example of a gambling. You know, I think it's a good place to stop, so let's stop here. And I'll see you next week, okay? Thank you.